Hello folks, I wanted to make a quick video on the sixth trumpet of Revelation. Unfortunately, this is not a light topic. It's got a lot of myths related to it. Because, you know, the sixth trumpet is a 200 million man army war. So the first thing I want to do is dispel some myths about that. In my opinion, share my opinions on this topic. So, you know, if you've been paying attention to any of my videos, then you know that I already think that, you know, the sixth trumpet great earthquake was on March 11th, 2011. That was the Fukushima earthquake, caused multiple meltdowns in Japan. They shut down 50 reactors throughout Japan. At least 8 reactor cores worth of fuel at Fukushima began melting down after March 11, 2011. And so each one of those cores is at least, well, approximately 3 times the size of Chernobyl. And, you know, Chernobyl was a partial core release over a few days, and then they recontained it. So a fraction of the size of one core in Japan. And Chernobyl, you know, they made an exclusion zone of about 1,000 square miles. So Fukushima has had continuous releases into the environment. It hasn't been recontained. Japan has lied about it continuously along the way. The only reason we know anything about it at all is because, you know, the buildings were pretty much destroyed. And there were photos that the buildings were destroyed. And there's been a few people online who have been covering it religiously, thankfully, for them. Otherwise, you know, the governments would just completely cover it up, like they've covered up just literally a dozen other meltdowns over the years. But this is by far the worst in the history of mankind, in modern recorded history of mankind. In Japan, that being Fukushima. And again, we don't know how many other reactor cores throughout Japan melted down. The point I'm trying to make is that the description outlined in the first trumpet, second trumpet, third trumpet are all related to fallout. There are different aspects of fallout impacting the environment over time. And the second trumpet being the fish dying off. And if you're paying any attention to the news, you'll know that they closed the fisheries along the west coast. The sardines have collapsed. The starfish have collapsed. And now the salmon have collapsed. You know, they're finding sea lions with leukemia, like a massive number of them, like 20%. And the ones that aren't, you know, and they're starving to death, can't get enough food. The starfish have completely... they've pretty much been decimated along the coast. Not decimated, you know. Decimated would mean like 1 in 10. This is like 90 to 100% melting, you know, just disappearing. And it's man-made pollution. Now, the pollution, you have to remember, though, you know, that great earthquake, 9.0, they dumped all kinds of garbage in the ocean and in like steel drums. Just literally tens of thousands of barrels of toxic waste. They dump it out there and you know, and they kick the can, basically. So they did that 50 years ago. They did it 40 years ago. They did it 30 years ago. So they did it 20 years ago. They did it 10 years ago. They're doing it today. They're dumping crap in the ocean. And then they, you know, they say that it dilutes. Yeah, it dilutes. And then it when it reaches a certain threshold where life can't endure it, the life dies. And so you've got rusting cans on the bottom of the ocean, and then you've got a great earthquake, you know, shaking those around. Lots of earthquakes, you know, rise in earthquake activity as predicted in the Bible. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make, we're probably coming up, in my opinion, on the fourth trumpet. And then the fifth trumpet's going to be 5 months of rioting. The locusts in the fifth trumpet are riot police, and they have power to sting people for 5 months. And of course, riot police, you know, they're dressed up in their padded armor. They, you know, they have their chest pieces, and they have their weapons that sting people. And of course, on a lot of riot police, they'll have insignia on their foreheads, on their helmets rather, that are golden. So there's your golden crowns. So all of the criteria are there for riot police, described in the fifth trumpet. So that's going to be, you know, and it seems to say that, you know, it indicates that the has something to do with the abyss, you know, and so that may also be a reference to, see, the fourth and the fifth trumpet could be also related to the multiple meltdowns, because the multiple meltdowns, not only do they aerosolize and then cause hail, which would be like lumps, in the Greek, the word lump, or tuberculi, so in the lungs, not only do they cause tumors, over time, you know, it does take time, you know, it takes like, the earliest symptoms would be thyroid nodules from radiation, and then there's leukemia, and then there's, I think lung cancer, and then, I mean, these hardcore diseases, and then there's, you know, other tumors that begin to show up. And it's like about 10 years. So we're right now, we're at 6 years after the disaster. And I'm jumping back to Fukushima again for some reason. But, yeah, it's biblical. We're in biblical times. This is the point I'm trying to make. And if you've been paying attention to my videos, then you know that on March 15, 2011, that Fukushima, you know, first plume from the first melted down cores began to reach North America, and then it traveled on, you know, after that to Europe and Russia, which would be Magog. And so on 3/15, 2011, it reached the people who live in safety in the coastlands, being North America. And that's actually scriptural as well, because in Ezekiel 8 and 39, it describes all of the Gog Magog nations in the Gog Magog war, being Iran, Turkey, which would be Gomer and Togarma, Meshach and Tubal being Russia, and then Libya and Sudan, or Ethiopia. And those, you know, Ethiopia and Sudan have had rebel mercenaries recruited to go fight in Syria. And I heard something like they're getting paid, you know, $100,000, $200,000 in gold or something like that from the various intelligence agencies that have put the mercenary armies into Syria. And they're fulfilling biblical prophecy because they've got all the Gog Magog combatants. Ezekiel 39 verse 9 indicates about 7 years of people looting. And normally when you have a war, people, you know, they do what they got to do to survive. But what happened in Syria is the Syrian government withdrew from about 80-90% of the countryside. And so that left all those people out there with, you know, abandoned military supply caches, military bases, that they could go and they could get supplies from, food, fuel for cooking, weapons that they could potentially sell for food or whatever they needed to live on and get by. So for 7 years in Ezekiel 39 verse 9, it indicates that they would be burning the weapons, consuming the weapons as it were, for 7 years. And then, so in Ezekiel 39 verse 6, it says, you know, pretty much at, it's basically at the time of the war. So the day that the war in Syria began, 3/15/2011, radiation fallout from Japan hit North America, the people who live in safety in the coastlands. And that's what it says exactly in Ezekiel 39 verse 6. Because what happens is the jet stream goes from east to west. So it blew from Japan over North America, over Europe, over Russia. It circles every 42 days or something like that. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is Ezekiel 39 verse 6, I will send fire on those who live in safety in the coastlands. And and on those in Magog, and then they will know that I am the Lord. So, you know, the very same day. Okay, so this is a biblical times that we're living in. Israel exists after thousands of years. They even, you know, they recaptured Jerusalem in 1968. Jerusalem was restored to Israel. They rebuilt the city with a wall, the West Bank Barrier, 430-mile-long wall, just as Daniel 9:25 indicates. Similarly, on Feast of Weeks, so the word weeks in Hebrew can mean 7 days, 7 years, or the yearly Feast of Weeks. So on Feast of Weeks, per Daniel 9:27, the leaders of Russia, Brazil, India, and China met to confirm a covenant with many. They represent 40% of the world's population. And that was your covenant with many. So in the midst of that week, they've been ending sacrifice and tribute. That's that they've been moving away from the dollar as a sacrifice and tribute. And that's literally what I think it means. So these are biblical times. You know, the Bible is trying to communicate with us if we will let it, if we will let God communicate with us. You know, it is filtered, you know, it is translated. But, you know, when you believe in Jesus Christ and you turn away from your sins, sin is basically God saying, don't be stupid. Don't injure yourself. Don't injure other people. And if you look at all the things in the Bible, it's basically trying to keep giving people instructions so that we're not injuring ourselves. For the most part, or other people. And so the same is true, you know, currently there's all these, you know, descriptions about the modern world, and yes, for thousands of years people have been looking for these things to happen. Literally billions of people have read the scriptures and tried to understand these things, and you know, a lot of people spent their lives thinking wrong things, right? And so could I be wrong? Yes, I could be wrong. I've been wrong about things before. But I don't think I'm wrong about these things I'm sharing with you now, or I wouldn't share them with you. Because my goal in sharing this information with you is hoping that you will realize that Jesus Christ is about to come back and you repent of your sins. And choose to live righteously, because the consequences aren't what they say. You know, the consequences aren't eternity in a lake of molten sulfur. Well, I mean, the lake of molten sulfur is a place where people go to be cremated and they cease to exist. Now, the Creator God, He can recreate people as many times as He wants. So death has no hold over, you know, whoever God wants to resurrect. But He's going to resurrect everyone. So it's like 100 billion people that are going to be resurrected on a new earth. And on that new earth, He's going to cause the new Jerusalem to come down from heaven. The new Jerusalem will be a 1,500-mile walled region with three gates on each side. So there's going to be four sides, 1,500 miles on each side. Approximately, maybe 1,400 to 1,500 miles. You know, it's ancient unit of measurement, so, you know, it's not exactly precise. But it's big. It's very big. There's enough room in there for everyone on the earth. But that doesn't mean everyone on the earth is going to get to go in there. And that, you know, that 1,500-mile region will be governed by Jesus directly. And inside of there, that will be the kingdom of heaven on a future new earth. So the rationale for creating a new earth and having this kingdom is, well, God needs to recreate the earth because mankind has polluted it. Originally, Adam, for example, lived in the garden. He was created in the garden, he was created perfect. The first man, he lived 930 years after that, but he did not get to eat of the tree of life that was in the middle of the garden because, you know, he got fired from his job as a gardener in the garden. And he was told not to eat of it. Sorry about that. I ran out of the space, and so I gotta try and pick this up where I left off. Basically, God recreates the earth because mankind has polluted this earth, you know, between the fallout and the radiation and the heavy metals and all that terrible stuff, pollution. He recreates the earth and, you know, cleans up the environment. And then on that new earth, there'll be a 1,500-mile region, a walled region, that's going to be governed by Jesus Christ directly. That'll be the kingdom of heaven on a future new earth. So you've got 100 billion people, and only some of them get to go inside the New Jerusalem. The New Jerusalem is actually big enough for everyone who's ever lived to live in. They have a lot of space. It's very big, 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles. And it could be multiple levels within it. I don't know. It doesn't say it, but it's possible. So it could be big enough for everyone who's ever lived. So a couple other myths that I wanted to dispel fairly rapidly before I go into the main topic. Adam, he was created perfect on a new earth and in a healthy new body. And he did not eat of the tree of life, and Adam lived 930 years. It stands to reason that after the resurrections, everyone's going to be resurrected on a new earth in healthy new bodies, healthy mentally, healthy emotionally, healthy physically, that they could potentially live 930 years. Potentially. It seems like a long time in comparison, because mankind's polluted the earth so much that, you know, it's down to 70, 80 years of average, on average, for people to live. You used to live 900, even without eating the tree of life. Already, mankind is approaching technologically the point where it could develop the knowledge to potentially extend life for eternity, potentially. I mean, that's a real possibility. But the point is, Jesus Christ comes back. And he's going to recreate the earth, and on that new earth, inside of his kingdom, with the tree of life, people can eat of that fruit of tree of life and extend life potentially for millions, billions, trillions of years. But outside, they might not get to have access to the tree of life. So when they grow old, potentially 900 years, and they die, you're talking about, you know, a huge portion of 100 billion people growing old and then dying on a new earth after Jesus comes back, after the resurrection of the dead. They're developing intense, passionate, emotional relationships. And you can just imagine that instead, you know, because, naturally people would want to remember their loved ones. And if they have hundreds of years to remember them, and they know they're going to have hundreds of years, they might build memorials, statues, mausoleums to remember them by. But the issue is, God does not practice, or he doesn't tolerate idolatry, so there won't be those type of things in general, and so what the policy will probably be for people in general to be taken to the lake of molten sulfur and cremated, and then they will cease to exist in the lake of molten sulfur. I don't think that God tortures anyone for millions, billions, trillions of years, but since their ashes are now in the lake of molten sulfur, that's their place for eternity. So you get this kind of misconception where it seems like God's going to like continuously regenerate their flesh, and then they're tormented, or some of their souls are tormented. No, they cease to exist when they go into the lake of molten sulfur, in my opinion. God isn't in the business of torturing people for millions, billions, trillions of years. That's just absurd. It's pointless. Oh, you made a mistake once in your life, and now God's going to torture someone for millions, billions, trillions of years? I don't think so. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. It's not just. God is a just God. He loves justice. And part of the rationale for all this is people who God is discerning who can function in the New Jerusalem, the kingdom of heaven, who has the personality traits to potentially live in a society for millions, billions, trillions of years without screwing it up, right? Because you can't have murderers going around murdering people and still have people living for eternity because they're murdering people, they're dying. With that in mind, God could resurrect people. There's all these workarounds, right, with God, because he can do pretty much anything he wants. But this is you know, apparently what's described in the Bible is apparently optimal. And so, you know, for a lot of people, it's going to be optimal for them to be outside the New Jerusalem because of their choices, their character traits. For them to live outside potentially for 930 years and then be cremated and cease to exist. Now, obviously, it would be even better if they, you know, could repent, choose to do what's right, and, you know, go into the New Jerusalem and eat of the fruit of the tree of life and live for eternity, provided that they were willing to forego those character traits, which would totally screw up the kingdom of heaven and make it, you know, like a social version of hell. No. So God wants the kingdom of heaven to be, you know, heaven, a nice place where, you know, people get along and are having a, you know, happy life, you know, and there's joy. Not where people are, you know, torturing people or injuring other people. Sin is basically God saying, don't be stupid. You know, stop injuring yourself, stop injuring other people and offending God, right? Because there are things that he designed. He expects them to work a certain way, and then when we do other things that are offensive to him, you know, and he's potentially seeing everything. So, and you know, there's various persons of God too. So God the Father, he would be seeing everything, and very, very likely the Holy Spirit is to a certain extent seeing everything. And I think the Holy Spirit, he can vary in the amount of the Holy Spirit that each person has. So he's the living water, and Jesus, you know, he indicated to the Samaritan woman, if you knew who it was who was speaking with you, you'd ask for living water, and that would be the Holy Spirit. And he's the counselor, and so he helps a lot, and especially if we listen to him and take his advice, he can lead us into all truth, and he can help us change our hearts. God the Father helps us change the hearts in Jesus Christ. So that was a little bit of a tangent, but I wanted to kind of explain what's occurring in general. So, I mean, there's other aspects to this, you know, and some of the character traits of people who won't be permitted to go into the New Jerusalem. And Jesus is going to say, and he said, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we do X, Y, Z in your name? Cast out demons, you know, whatever. Heal the sick, move a mountain in your name. And he's going to say, away from you, I never knew you. And it's entirely possible. A lot of people are being deceived. I mean, there are literally Satanists in the pulpits, you know, and you're getting disinformation in the news or on TV, on the radio and in the pulpit. And the question, you know, there's a couple of questions. Are they doing it intentionally or not? Because, you know, obviously there are Satanists that have infiltrated the church in some cases. And then you have people and there's a lot of people who are just trying to figure things out in the middle of the darkness, and they're propagating misinformation. And, you know, I've been wrong about things. I don't think I'm wrong about the information I'm sharing with you. Otherwise, I wouldn't share it with you. And my hope is, again, that as many as possible can go in and partake of that eternal blessing. Because there is nothing in the universe that is more precious than, I guess, the, you know, eating of the tree of life and participating in that perfectly wonderful, awesome society that is the New Jerusalem. I mean, Jesus the Creator God, he created the universe in 6 days. And he's had over 100,000, he's had hundreds of thousands of days to work on the New Jerusalem to prepare it for those who enter in. So I'm hoping that you'll choose Christ and figure out whatever it is, you know, that he wants you to do, and do it. Do the Father's will. And go in, you know, participate in that eternal society. So there are some conditions described in general, you know, for people trying to get a rudimentary idea of you know, why are people outside? Idolatry, murderers, sorcery. Sorcery is actually really big because it's drug abuse or drug use or drug production. I'm not sure which one. I'm still learning about sorcery and what it might actually mean, because they don't really cover it in any of the churches I've been to. But if you've seen any videos on it, you know, put the link in the comments and I'll check them out. So sorcery could be drug abuse, drug use. It could be drug production or research. I don't know which one, or some combination thereof. But it's offensive to the Creator, and it kind of makes sense, right? Because you got trillions of cells in a human body, billions of molecular machines inside of each cell, and you know, just phenomenally complex, self-replicating on a macroscopic and a microscopic, self-ordering on a macroscopic and a microscopic scale. And then we just meddle with it. You know, mankind just meddles, putting these drugs in. And who knows when they combine with other chemicals, what the effects are. And, you know, one of the possibilities that the sorcerers are the people that are putting drugs in and giving them to other people. So it's administration, potentially, of drugs. I'm not sure which one. But I think it's important. It's important in the scriptures. You know, there's a couple billion Christians on the planet and very few people are talking about sorcery. What is it? What's offensive to the Creator about it? And then propagating that information so that, you know, hopefully there'll be less sin on the earth, less people injuring each other. But, you know, there's the drugs, the legal drugs, the prescription and over-the-counter drugs, and then there's the illegal drugs, which, of course, both of those potentially, well, especially the illegal drugs, is they're trying to push a product that is addictive, right? So it's chemically addictive, and people, there's continuous demand for their product so they can enrich themselves idolatrously. And, there's a scripture that says no idolater has any part in the kingdom of heaven. So the greedy person, the covetous person, outside. They're not going to be able to function in society, in a healthy society, for millions, billions, trillions of years without screwing it up. And that's the rationale there. Now, in Christ, people can repent. God can give them a new heart, changing their heart, so that they can have a personality that isn't going to screw up the society for millions, billions, trillions of years. Now, I guess the rationale is if we could figure it out in this life, then in this present darkness, then we could probably function in the brilliance that is in the presence of Jesus Christ as the Lord of Lords and King of Kings in the midst of the New Jerusalem, without screwing up too badly. So there's sorcery, idolatry, sexual morality, that's huge. Billions of hours of pornography on the internet. If you look at a woman lustfully, you commit adultery with her in your heart. Jesus indicated something to that effect. What exactly is sexual morality? It's a huge, important question. Really not thoroughly covered in general in the churches. And there might be some authors out there among the tens of thousands of commentaries and books that really nail it, you know, that really cover it thoroughly. But, sifting through all of them to find those is very difficult. It would be cool if someone created a website, I think, that took, like, the very best sources of information on any particular topic in Christianity and then compiled them. You know what I mean? Is it like a reference guide for novices, you know, and for anyone, you know? Because I've been at this Christian walk for decades, and I still don't know. I don't know what sorcery is exactly. Sexual morality, I don't know what exactly sexual morality is. You know, is it having relations outside of marriage? Is it obviously adultery, right? Because adultery is one of the Ten Commandments. So is it looking at pornography? You know, all these possibilities. So there's all kinds of sexual deviancy in the world today. It's pervasive. It's a very dark world. So let's see. So there's murderers, there's idolaters, there's sexual immoral. And those who love and practice deception, which is very pervasive as well. You know, deception is what got the whole world screwed up in the first place. The serpent deceiving Eve. And that led to, you know, this complete disaster that is the world today. And so, yeah, you can't have someone who's going to be practicing deception for millions, billions, trillions of years in a healthy society and expect it to function. So we have to give up those things which are offensive. I mean, they just couldn't function for millions, billions, trillions of years in a society. Society wouldn't function that way. So I guess I'm starting to ramble a little bit on this topic. There's one other thing about idolatry I just wanted to mention is there's already an idolatrous religious system. It's the faith-based fiat currency worship, which is pervasive throughout the earth. It's all controlled by the Antichrist, false prophet, Rothschilds. They own and control the central banks in virtually every nation on the planet. You know, and they're foreigners. So why is a foreigner being given authority to set economic policy in these various countries and choose what's best for those countries? Like in the United States, for example, you know, it's a foreigners. Foreigners own the central bank. And then the central banking system controls not only the economic policy of the United States, but also the stock markets, literally control over the SEC. And so that's a big deal. In the central, or the Rothschild central banks in China, the Rothschild central banks and the International Monetary Fund, they control that. So yeah, it's a big idolatrous, faith-based, state-sponsored system that's being forced on the world. And few people recognize it because they're deceptive. War, the first line in the Art of War, you know, I think it's the first line, it talks about deception. War, and they don't call it a religion. It's a faith-based belief system with idols, you know, these currency notes that are being pushed on everyone throughout the world. And okay, so on to the main topic, and this is already, 30 minutes? Okay, 30 minutes into this, and now we're going to talk about the sixth trumpet. So yeah, the sixth trumpet is a 200 million man army war. A lot of people in the churches are thinking that this is and a lot of authors are projecting this as if it's going to be a Muslim army. Now, it obviously cannot be a Muslim army because everyone is in the Christian world is expecting it to be a Muslim army. And it indicates in Revelation chapter 9 and in Revelation chapter 16 that mankind does not repent. Even after all the seals, the trumpets, and the first few bowls, mankind is not repenting. And so if the 200 million man sixth trumpet war was a Muslim army, I think people would repent, don't you? That's what they're expecting, it to be a Muslim army. Now there will be Middle Eastern wars, like I said. Gog Magog war is going on in Syria right now. Israel will eventually be invaded by someone. You know, in ancient Syria, ancient Syria is composed of lands that were part of Israel. So as far as God is concerned, you know, or as far as the prophets of the Bible are concerned, are they going to include Syria as part of Israel? Are they going to, you know, that's what they knew, right? That's the worldview that they had. Where was Israel? It went all the way to the Euphrates through Syria. So Syria is part of ancient Israel. It is the mountains of northern Israel. And again, I'm going off on a tangent, but yeah, you've got Isaiah 17, Damascus is destroyed, becomes a ruinous heap. Most of Damascus has become a ruinous heap. They just completely leveled the beautiful, beautiful buildings and streets that were in Damascus and throughout Syria. They just completely devastated that whole country. And it's basically, this is a tangent. Okay, so Ezekiel 30, the Muslim 200 million man army idea is it's misnomer, it's misinformation in my view. I mean, it could happen. I could be wrong, but it wouldn't really be an army. It would be a ragtag coalition of, you know, like, because there's like 70, 80 different Muslim nations, and they all use different military equipment. So none of their weapon systems would work. You know, they wouldn't have interchangeable parts. The munitions wouldn't work with each other. So even if there's a coalition, let's say there's two Muslim coalitions, a northern and a southern coalition, they fight each other. That's entirely possible, but I don't think that's what it is. I don't think that's what the sick trumpet is. But let's say that did happen. Like so many people have indicated that that's what they thought, and that's what's widely held in the church. I just can't conceive of them actually accomplishing anything militarily, because you've got all these units, all these nations, they don't know how to work together. They've never worked together. They don't trust each other. They don't have the protocols to communicate behind the scenes efficiently. So one unit, you know, from one nation pulls back, leaves a hole in the flank. And then, you know, then they're overrun. So it would be totally ineffective. They would be such low morale because they wouldn't be able to trust the units from other nations on their flanks. And, and logistically, just think about the logistics, supplying because basically the Middle East has every weapon system known to mankind from every nation. And that sounds, you know, oh no, right? They have all, the reality is they can't maintain all those weapon systems in time of war, logistically, because they're importing, they're not developing in the indigenous. I think Turkey has its own main battle tank, and I think Iran has its own main battle tank, but they're the only two nations that I could think of off the top of my head, except for Israel, that has its own main battle tank. So all their tanks, right, they're going to break down. They've got like every model that's ever existed since World War II. And, you know, from Russia, from Czechoslovakia, from Germany, you know, everywhere they can get tanks and weapon systems, they've gotten them. So it's going to be a complete hodgepodge. They wouldn't be able to, logistically, imagine the logistics of a 200 million man army. It's like over 100 billion meals per year. So that's food that needs to be grown, it needs to be harvested, it needs to be transported, it needs to be prepared. And yes, computers are making that much more easy to logistically keep track of, you know, where and get things to where they need to be on time and when they need to be there. But does the Middle East really have a computing capability? I suppose to a certain extent, but each nation would need to have their own logistics system, and you know, ammo supplies. It would just be a mess. It would be a complete disaster. I mean, the whole idea of a 200 million man army war is a complete disaster in the first place. No matter what, I mean, it's going to be a big disaster for everyone involved. But again, the Christian nations in the West, they don't repent, even though it's been predicted for thousands of years that this horrible sixth trumpet war would come upon the earth. And of course, it will happen over time. You know, it takes time to train 200 million troops. It takes time to recruit 200 million troops. And then deploy them. So, you know, it will happen over a number of years. And a lot of people have this misconception that everything in the book of Revelation happens in 7 years. It's totally a misconception. It's not based on anything other than like Daniel 9:27, which I already indicated happened in 2009. The covenant confirmed in 2009. That is not what it's talking about. You know, everything in the book of Revelation does not happen in 7 years. The biblical calendar, as described in the Old Testament, is on a 7-year heptadic basis. It's on a daily, a weekly, a monthly, a yearly, a 7-year period cycle. So 7 sevens, 49 years, plus a jubilee year, that's 50 years. So 250 years, you get a century. That's pretty much the biblical calendar as it relates to the modern calendar. So there, the biblical concept, I guess, doesn't have a decade. It has a 7-year period. That's the difference between the modern calendar and the biblical calendar. So this presumption that everything happens in a 7-year period is just incorrect. It's a fallacy, and it leads a lot of people astray. And when we propagate that idea, we're leading a lot of people astray, because they're expecting all these terrible events to occur in a short period of time and to be obvious, and people still don't repent. It's illogical, it's irrational, because if all the events in the book of Revelation happened that rapidly in a 7-year period, people would repent, obviously. Even the infidel heretics who have no concept or belief in God, even though, you know, I talked about all these things that have already happened, you know, Gog Magog is going on right now. The Bible is full of scriptures that have come to pass or are coming to pass. The Bible, there's nothing like the Bible on the earth. I mean, it is its own entity, as it were, the Word of God. So, a living Word, and it is coming to pass in real time. There is no other religion like Christianity. Believe in Jesus Christ, if you don't already. And if you do, repent. You know, everybody just, we need to, this is the time, Jesus is coming back, so live righteously. So dismissing that, dispelling that myth that everything happens in a 7-year period. Yes, there's a 7-year period of 42 months and 1260 days mentioned in chapter 11 of Revelation. That is for the two witnesses, pretty much. That does not mean everything else in Revelation happens in a 7-year period. Quite the contrary, you would expect it to be, you know, the other chapters are happening before and after, meaning over a more expansive period of time, just on the surface of it. The reality is there is overlap between everything, because, you know, like I said, Fukushima happened, and now we deal with the consequences of that great earthquake. And so there's fire in the form of fallout throughout the rest of the period. And again, trumpet, 200 million man army war, there's nuclear power plants throughout the earth. And if that sixth trumpet, 200 million man army war, well, when it happens, because the Bible says it's going to happen, or indicates it's going to happen, then more than likely there will be more meltdowns. And so that's going to increase the amount of fallout in the atmosphere, further causing damage to everything on the earth, all life. Hence why Jesus, why the Creator needs to come back and recreate the earth. So that's what I think it isn't. So now let me tell you what I think it is. The sixth trumpet, 200 million man army war. I think it's India and China. Now first let me just share with you how dark India and China are as places. Now, in Revelation chapter 13, it talks about a mark of the beast. China has already forced a billion people, everyone 16 years old and older, to receive a national identity card, a mark in their hand, with a 6 plus 6 plus 6. So count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. So count 666. 6 plus 6 plus 6 equals 18 digits. China has forced everyone in China, 16 years old and older, to receive a 6 plus 6 plus 6 equals 18 digit number. It's called a citizen identity number. It's a number they take as a name that is being issued by the government of China. And so that's offensive to the Creator, because when Jesus comes back, he's going to give people who overcome a new name written on a white stone indicating, you know, stones can last for millions, billions, trillions of years. So he's not going to need to replace those IDs, those identification stones. So he's giving a new name from the government, the kingdom of heaven, to those who overcome and can enter in on white stones. And so if people are choosing to take new names from the government of men, in the scriptural case, China, then they're opting out of taking a name from Jesus Christ. And so they'll be outside to have their part in the lake of molten sulfur. Now, again, the Creator God can resurrect people. And there's no guarantee that he will resurrect anyone after the resurrection, but it's entirely possible that he will. It's possible that, yes, the people have their part in the lake of molten sulfur, you know, and then God, because it's possible Jesus resurrects people again. Possible. It's not a promise, though. He can do, you know, he can resurrect people. I mean, he resurrected Lazarus. Although, you know, the lake of molten sulfur, people cease to exist in the sense that they're being atomized and ashes. Anyway, tangent. So China is so dark they forced everyone to receive a 6 + 6 + 6 = 18-digit number as a name. It's a citizen identity number. It's a number for a citizen. It's a number for a person. A name for a person, versus a driver's license number, which is a number for a driver's license, or a birth certificate number. So it's a number for a birth certificate. It's not a number for the baby, okay? It's a number for the birth certificate, and the birth certificate is the, you know, for the baby to whatever, you know. I don't know. I haven't looked into that that much, but Social Security account number. An account number for Social Security. It's not a name, it's not a number as a name for people. So if you're in a nation, though, that has a national identity card, you need to be wary about whether or not that is offensive to the Creator. And if you care and you want to have eternal life in Jesus Christ and go on and eat in the New Jerusalem, and consider, you know, just because it talks biblically about the largest implementation of this mark of the beast, doesn't mean that you're off the hook if you're in, say, Mexico and you have a national identity card. That could be also offensive to the Creator God. So really need to consider that as a Christian, if you're a Christian and you want to have eternal life, is that what's different about your national identity card than the one that they have in China? The mark of the beast, what's different? Why is it less offensive? And so in the United States, they're doing they've got a whole slew of identification schemes going on. Now is really not the time to be participating in identity schemes from the governments of men. If you want to participate in the government of Jesus Christ and inside the New Jerusalem and the kingdom of heaven. And there are indeed, like, there's probably like dozens of nations around the world that are implementing national identity cards. And Israel has a national identity card. But I want to talk about China and India. So the largest scale implementation of national identity cards on the planet is China and India. So China has, you know, they've done what they've done. And, you know, if you're in China, the thing about China and India is in that region of the world, 97 out of 100 people do not believe in Jesus Christ. They are literally denying Christ. They are antichrist in spirit. That's what the scriptures indicate. If you deny the Jesus Christ, if you deny Jesus Christ, then you're have the spirit of antichrist. That's what the Bible and the scriptures indicate. So anyone who's not believing in Jesus Christ is the spirit of antichrist. So those nations are very dark places, but they're very populated places. And 3% of those people, at least nominally, you know, they might not have a Bible. They might not have a scripture teacher on a regular basis. But they heard the gospel. Someone came and preached it to them at some point. And they at least nominally believed in Jesus Christ. So that's approximately 3% of the population of India and China. And that adds up to a lot of people being impacted by what's going on in China and India with their national identity card schemes. So now, there's a few caveats to this. India has... So China has the identity card and the number, right? India has a, just recently. So China's program began in 1984, and it gradually increased over time. You know, it's voluntary, mandatory. Now everyone in China has to carry their identity card with them in public at all times. And they have RFID chips in them so they can be detected, and they can scan a crowd if they're rioting or whatever and find out exactly who's in the crowd. And then they'll detain whoever doesn't have their cards, those type of things. So, or potentially. And then what they're doing in India is they're doing a mark on the forehead. They're using people's biometric eye scans, retina scans, as a form of identification. And of course, there's a card, there's a national identity card, but the Indian program has began in 2009. It's already enrolled over 1,100 million people, so over 1.1 billion people. It's the largest. It passed China, I think, or they're right about the same amount of people in both countries. Now, the beast that rises up out of the earth has two horns, so that would be China and India, in my opinion. That's what they're talking about, I think. I don't know at what stage of the scriptures in Revelation chapter 13, the implementation, because it occurs over time, is, you know, is it to the point where those people do not get to partake of the tree of life or not? I don't know. But obviously, you know, they need to hear the narrative to make the decision for themselves. And again, it matters to 3%, 3 out of 100 people, 97 out of 100 people could care less in China or India about whether or not they take the mark of the beast, because they're completely ignorant. They're godless heathens. They haven't read the scriptures. No one's talked to them about that, or they reject the gospel outright. But for the 3%, you know, of 3% of 3 billion is still a lot of people. As about 100 million people in China and India that believe in Christ, that are in nations that have these national identity card programs. Now, right now, like I said, India began its program in 2009. They've already enrolled 1,100 million people because they tied it to a distribution of the welfare benefits. So if you want to receive a benefit from the government of India, they have to have the cards. But I think it's a voluntary. So in China, it seems to be mandatory. But China has in their constitution religious practice of religious freedom, and obviously, not taking the mark of the beast that rises up out of the earth is part of Christian religion, thousands of years. So they should be able to get an exemption. It may interfere, though, with their them economically and how they conduct commerce. And I don't know to what extent, you know, the people in those nations have cared and they are choosing to opt out of those national identity card programs. And again, around the world, there's no reason to think any other nation's national identity card is any less offensive to the Creator. So yeah, it's a big deal. And you know what's really sad is every year about 100 million people between China and India reach the age where they're required, or they, like in China, at the age of 16, everyone's required to take a national, participate in the national identity card. And then at the age of 18 in India, so about, then they can enroll, I think, again, voluntarily, in ignorance, potentially, or maybe they're choosing not to because they know better, than to participate in the Mark of the Beast system. But that's what I think it is. I think they're scanning the eyes. And the point I'm trying to make in general, you know, is it's, they're godless heathen nations. And in for the most part, except for that small remnant of Christians. And so repenting. I think what's going to happen, though, is even though China and India have entered into the BRICS alliance, they have, you know, since India annexed Tibet, and they have a long time rivalry, China, and so the 200 million man army war could come about in a number of different ways. It could be a coalition of nations. And it's possible that the godless nations will be involved. So it's very likely to just be Asian-centric, because most of the godless nations are in Asia, which would mean that the majority of the 2 billion Christians wouldn't necessarily take much notice if there was a big war and it was totally focused in Asia. And if it happened in the Middle East, right next to Israel, if it happened, you know, next to Europe, but in North Africa, a lot of Christians would take note. So that's why I don't think it's the Muslim coalition to make the 200 million man army. I think it is the kings of the East, China and India, and I think they're going to fight each other, but I could be wrong. If they fight everyone else, then it's going to be, you know, a very large war. But I think they're going to fight each other, and I think they're going to, over time, they're going to field 200 million men. You know, China has the world's largest economy now. They passed the United States. China has the world's largest manufacturing. I mean, typically, whenever a nation has the world's largest economy, they become the global hegemon. I mean, that's basically what it means. They have the world's largest economy. And after they become the world's largest economy, they become the world's largest, most powerful military. That's what's happened historically throughout history. It was Great Britain, and then it went to the United States. And now it's going over to China. China's surpassing the United States. And I think that now you've got the... So China's GDP is estimated by some to be as high as four times as high as in the United States in a few decades. So what that means is you've got this window of time where China is becoming enormously powerful economically, and then that translates to military power as well. Another example of potential military power is the education system. China is graduating 600,000 engineers each year. America is graduating 15,000 to 20,000 American engineers, or something like that. Some fraction, small fraction, 20, 30 times, 40 times more engineers in China are being graduated from their universities. From their school systems. And same thing's happening in India. So India and China, and they're using, I mean, those engineers are getting jobs building infrastructure, building industrial capacity, building intellectual capacity, building the technological capacity of their nations. And what that does is it prepares them to be able to fill the 200 million man army. And again, at the current wages in China, it would cost $1 trillion or $2 to fill the 100 million man army. And India would need to, you know, it would fill the 100 million man army potentially as well. And, you know, obviously they could fill smaller armies, especially if, like, Pakistan is also involved, or maybe Japan becomes involved as well in the 200 million man army war. But I think it's going to be focused for the most part on that border with India and China, and Pakistan's right there. So I think that those three nations are really going to go at it sometime in the next 7 years. And I think that because I have a timeline that I kind of, it's just a really rough guesstimate based on the presumption that 9/11 is the first, 9/11 and the Afghan war is the first seal. And that the March 11, 2011 earthquake is the sixth seal. So that the duration between seals would be about 700 days. And then you extrapolate that out to the sixth trumpet. And yeah, sometime between now and the end of 2024, the 600 million man army war should begin. If that, you know, if it's actually, if the duration between seals is consistent for the duration between trumpets. There's no reason to think that that is the case. A musical instrument is going to sound a lot, you know, a trumpet's going to sound a lot more rapidly than a royal ceremony in heaven involving Jesus Christ, the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, opening the seals one at a time, and then angels coming, and then the riders going out. You know, that's going to take time in heaven for that to happen, versus the musical instruments, the trumpets being played. I don't know. It could be, I mean, it could be longer, possibly, but I would think it'd be shorter. So what that means is sometime in the next 7 years, by the end of 2024, I think that the 200 million man army war will begin. but in Revelation chapter 9 indicates that even after the war begins, people do not repent. So if it was a Muslim army, people would repent. People are looking for a Muslim army. So I don't think that's what it is. I think it's going to be the Indian and China fighting each other. Again, they're godless nations for the most part. They don't know the scriptures, and they have all the criteria. They have the manpower, and they're building the industrial, and they have the knowledge to build the military industrial complexes in those nations. You know, they're building the industry. And once those things in a society are developed enough, usually the governments turn to building their military industrial complex. So yeah, I think that's what's going to happen. I don't know if I've left anything out. Have I left anything out on this topic that I could share with you to, let's see. Sixth trumpet, 200 million man army war. Well, I think that's about it, really. I think that covers most of the information I've researched and meditated on and fasted and prayed and about the Bible. I spent thousands of hours over the years studying the Bible and meditating on it, and fasting and praying and trying to understand the Bible. And I want to make this video to share that information that I have gathered. Thousands of videos online I've watched about the topic, about these topics, not necessarily just this topic, but yeah, this. Not a whole lot of people talk about the sixth trumpet, 200 million man army. It should be one of the more obvious events in the Bible. A lot of people are looking for that meteorite in the second trumpet, but the great mountain that was cast into the sea. It actually is the mountainous, the great mountain. The word mountain can mean mountainous region. So there isn't going to be a mountain being thrown into the sea. It's talking about Japan and the mountainous region of Japan pouring, because the word was cast in the Greek can be translated as to pour. So Japan is pouring contaminated water on fire with fallout into the Pacific Ocean for like 2,200 days now, some days. So that scripture has already happened. So people looking for a meteorite from the sky, that's not actually biblical. It's just a translation error. The translators have to choose from multiple word meanings, and they have to make a consistent narrative. It's kind of sad that most of the translations stick to the same narrative. They don't want to rock the boat, I guess, by presenting other ideas. But if you do, you can go on Bible Gateway and you can look at parallel of 100 different Bible translations, depending on how many languages you can read, and get a better idea of what the scriptures actually mean. But you can also go on Blue Letter Bible. I found this, that they have a lexicon built right into their website, and you can click on it and you can look at each Greek word and look at the Strong's concordance, or Strong's lexicon, which would be a list of what Strong thought it meant 100 years ago, of what each word might possibly mean. The reality is that's not thorough at all, and words change over time, cultural context. So it's a tough. It can be difficult to. Comprehend, but it also explains why people don't repent, right? They were expecting a meteorite, second trumpet, the pastor's standing in the pulpit, the guy on the radio and the TV says meteorite, over and over again, over and over and over again. And the art of war is deception. If those people aren't outright Satanists, they're on the other, they're not for you, then they may just well be misinformed, or just, they picked up some information from disinformation agents, and then they disseminated it. So, it's tough to discern. Just keep an open mind. Again, you can go to the Blue Letter Bible, and you can see that exactly what I'm saying is right there in the scriptures. Oh, actually, that one I found on, did I find that one in Blue Letter? One of them I had to go to, it was a Wikipedia for different languages to find it. I think it may have been Hale. No, was it Hale? I can't remember at this point, but, sixth trumpet, 200 million man army war. What else? So both India and China are completely godless. Of course, the Muslims would be kind of, they don't believe in they don't study the scriptures, so they have no knowledge of the scriptures in general. I think that's it, really. I think that covers it. And what this is like, 2 hours, an hour and a half, 115 minutes. I think that's about it. I mean, I don't know. I tried making this video quite a number of times. So, I guess that covers the topic. Best regards.